Ladies and gentlemen, the mother of the groom, Mrs. J.D. Pryor. You may be seated. We are gathered together in the sight of God and in the presence of this company to join together Kenneth Pryor and Judy Martin in holy matrimony. Marriage is not to be entered into lightly, but reverently and in deep respect for God, who tells us in his word that marriage is a picture of the deep love that he has for us. Who gives this woman to be married to this man? A sacred moment that we are coming to in this service. Last week began the beginning of a series of messages going through the entire New Testament. And our evangelist last week took us through the Gospels. Today we are in the book of Acts. The book of Acts was written specifically to a man named Theophilus. And Luke had two purposes for writing this historical record to the church. First, he wanted to show that the gospel would move all the way through Judaism into Gentilism and around the world and even to places like the United States of America. But secondly, he revealed that the Holy Spirit was in the church. He wanted to emphasize the power of the baptism in the Holy Spirit as God's provision for empowering the church to do what he has called us to do. Kenneth and Judy, you are the church, and God has placed a holy calling upon you. At this time, I'm going to invite you to comfortably be seated for the presentation of the word. In the book of Acts, which records the first 30 years of the church, Luke traces the spread of the gospel from Jerusalem to Rome, mentioning no less than 32 countries, 54 cities, 9 Mediterranean islands, and 95 different people by name with a variety of government officials by their title. What does this have to do with the wedding of Kenneth and Judy? I submit to you everything. The book of Acts describes what Jesus continued to do and teach after he was ascended back to heaven by the power of the Holy Spirit working in and through the disciples. And that continued from generation to generation to generation, including Kenneth and Judy this very day. The book of Acts is not a typical wedding passage, but there is a powerful model for you to see of what a Christian marriage should look like in a couple by the name of Aquila and Priscilla. It's found in the book of Acts, chapter 18. Luke records this. After this, Paul left Athens and he went to Corinth, and he found a Jew named Aquila, a native of Pontus, recently come from Italy with his wife Priscilla. And because Claudius had commanded all the Jews to leave Rome, and he went to see them. And because he was of the same trade, he stayed with Aquila and Priscilla, and he worked with them because they were tent makers. He reasoned in the synagogue every Sabbath, and he tried to persuade both Jews and Gentiles. Last Sunday morning, we experienced a Passover Seder meal, and we learned how we as the Christian church can connect with Jews who have yet to understand Jesus is the Messiah. And we have functioned more as the Gentile church, reaching people without that long heritage of Jewish faith. Kenneth and Judy, I'll bet there are some people here this morning who think this ceremony is really a waste of time. I mean, you've been living together for 6 years, and were it not for the fact that both of you were married to other people for that entire 6 years, your relationship would have been common law in the state of Texas. The vast majority of your relationship, both of you were drug addicts. That's historical fact. And by the time I met the two of you, you were both sober, but a million miles from Jesus. Kenneth, you were guarded, and you were filled with doubt and personal disappointment. Everybody could see it in your eyes. Judy, shame and guilt controlled you like a puppeteer, just pulling the strings of your life and taking you to places you never wanted to go. But last year, right here in this building, each of you personally came to a place where you realized sober was not enough. And the transformation that's taken place in each of you is so obvious to anybody who's known you more than a year. Many of your family and friends are gathered, and they know you are not the same people today you were just 16, 18 months ago. Sure. Amen. Now, as soon as you felt the comforting presence and the forgiveness of Jesus, I watched both of you take steps to honor the Lord as your Savior. Your journey reminds me of Zacchaeus in Luke 19. I don't expect you folks to be able to read that passage, but I wanted you to know where it was. The very day that Zacchaeus met Jesus, there was a very visible transformation in his life. He said, hey, if I've defrauded anybody, I'm going to fix it. And when you came to that place to where you knew that you knew you were bought with a price, both of you did everything in your power to indicate your lives have been transformed by Jesus Christ. I could go into a lot of specifics. We'll let you tell these folks some of that stuff. My wife alluded to it, the fact that you kind of lived here about 3 months. If you didn't know that story, ask Kenneth about that later. I don't think it's a secret that you both had a boatload of baggage you were carrying when I met you. And the truth of the matter is, I know that you're still a little insecure about what kind of spouse you're going to be. Can I tell you, Judy? Can I tell you, Kenneth? If you want to be a good spouse, just continue to be a good Christian. Because the same thing that makes a good spouse is what makes a good Christian. And what makes a good Christian makes a good spouse. You just keep living for Jesus, and you'll be the best spouse that your mate could ever have. Which brings us back to Priscilla and Aquila and the model that they will provide for your marriage. I'd like to jump to Romans chapter 16 and read for you three verses. Paul says this in Romans chapter 16. Greet Priscilla and Aquila, my fellow workers in Christ Jesus, who risked their neck for my life, and who I not only give thanks, but all the churches of the Gentiles give thanks as well. Greet also the church in their house. Priscilla and Aquila are the first married couple, well, actually the second. The first ones got struck dead for lying to God, but that's a whole nother kettle of fish. Aquila and Priscilla honor Jesus from the get-go. And their marriage mattered to God. Judy and Kenneth, your marriage matters to God. When you read the scriptures and you read about Priscilla and Aquila, they don't seem that significant in the scriptures. They really don't. But they mattered to the kingdom in powerful ways. Many scholars believe that Apollos was the one who wrote the book of Hebrews. And Priscilla and Aquila were the ones that discipled Apollos, which means anybody who reads the book of Hebrews and what they received from God from having read that book of the Bible was influenced by a couple of generations removed. Kenneth and Judy, your marriage has that same kind of power where you can influence people's lives just like Aquila and Priscilla. Your marriage matters to God. Your ministry matters to God. And I'm convinced your couple love is going to touch people in ways none of us even know today. If you'd asked Aquila and Priscilla if they thought that they were going to influence one of the writers of the New Testament that were just tent makers. Oh, they were tent makers, but they were so much more. I suspect there were times in the shadow of the great Apostle Paul that Aquila and Priscilla maybe felt invisible or obscure or insignificant or undervalued or alone or hopeless. If you ever feel that way, I want to remind you, feelings are just that. It's just how you feel. But if you feel hopeless, there's hope in Jesus Christ. And if you feel alone, you never are, because he sticks closer than a brother. And even if you feel insignificant or undervalued, God values your marriage. Revelation chapter 2, verse 17 tells us that the Lord has written a special name for every one of us in stone. There's a new name for you, Judy. I remember when you were able to go back to Martin, how that blessed you. Jesus has another name for you. Kenneth, Jesus has another name for you. He knows you by that name. I've been known to hurt people's feelings by making up pet names for them. I picked it up from my father. And one of my dad's favorite sayings was, how you doing, bigger than me? My dad was a little overweight, and he was kind of mean to guys that were more overweight than him. Jesus isn't mean, but he's got a name for you, Kenneth. He's got a name for you, Jude, that's special for you. Thank God that you matter to him. Thank God that your marriage matters to him. And the work that you're doing for him right here in this community, it really matters. Kenneth and Judy, your marriage matters to God, and your marriage is gifted by God. You got to ask Kenneth about 301, because that was it, wasn't it? Ask Kenneth about 301. When God just,
hey.
He wouldn't have called him fatter than me. I'm looking for a different name. I can't think of one, but Jesus said to you, I've called you to lead. And it hit Kenneth like a ton of bricks, his gifting. Jesus said, let the little children come to me. And when I watched you minister to our children, wow. There's a lot of different ways God gifts pastors and prophets and teachers. Moses talked about artisans, singing. But Aquila and Priscilla were tent makers. And God used that. You're a truck driver. And God's using that. You're a landscaper. And God, well, I hope we can finally get you back on your feet. We'll use that again. The weeds are starting to get away. That was my weed girl right there. Kenneth and Judy, are you willing to fulfill all of the gifting that God has put in you, both individually and as a couple? Kenneth and Judy, are you willing to engage all of your gifts in divine partnership? If you are willing not only to marry each other, but if you are willing to allow God to use your marriage for his glory, then will you together say, we are willing? He gives ordinary people extraordinary gifts. And as your pastor, I see each one of those unique gifts you have. And as I'm stirring those up in you, I encourage you to stir them up in them. Now, before you take your vows, there's one more thing about marriage that you can see in Aquila and Priscilla's marriage that I want to encourage you. I want you to stir this up in your marriage. Aquila and Priscilla were risk takers. If I can go off script a little bit, Clay, bounce back to that passage in Romans 16 so folks can see that it specifically says Aquila and Priscilla risked their lives, not just for the Apostle Paul, but for the churches. They risked their lives. They stuck their neck out in ways they could have lost their own lives. Why were they risk takers? What was it that put that fearless abandon in that married couple? I think it's the company they kept, because they were close to the Apostle Paul. What made Paul such a risk taker? I think it was the company he kept. He was close to Jesus. See, the Lord took a risk when he called the Apostle Paul. Actually, he called a murderer named Saul. And he said, hey, murderer, I got a new job for you. And he became the Apostle Paul. See, the Lord took a risk on calling Paul. The Lord took a risk on calling me to be the officiant of your wedding. And he called me to be your pastor. He called Pat Hurlitz to be your pastor. And I know how many times I've failed as a pastor. I know how many mistakes I've made. I know how many times I felt like I blew it. And I find myself saying, Lord, why are you willing to risk the church on somebody as scatterbrained as me? And then Jesus gently reminds me, Jesus believes in me. We put so much emphasis on believing in Jesus. Jesus believes in you. Jesus believes in you. Never stop believing in you, Kenneth. Never stop believing in you, because God didn't. Never stop believing in what God is capable of doing through you. So, I encourage you to be risk takers like Aquila and Priscilla. Priscilla, yeah. It depends which verse you read. Sometimes it's Priscilla first, sometimes it's Aquila first. Be willing to be risk takers. Release your faith to risk your lives for Jesus. Risk your security, your comfort, your time, your preference for eternal souls. Jesus told a parable about people who got talents. One got five, one got two, and one got one. And the whole point of that was stick your neck out. Do something with what you've got. Risk it. It's not gambling. It's by faith stepping out. Priscilla and Aquila were Jews that risked their lives for Gentiles. In your marriage, the Lord is going to ask you to take risks for his glory. Because God is the God of the risk taker. God expects individuals. God expects groups. And God expects couples like you to risk things for his kingdom. Now you are about to take lifelong vows to one another. Go ahead. You can look each other in the eye for a minute instead of looking at me. You're about to take lifelong vows to one another, and these vows will be meaningless if you do not keep your vows that you made to the Lord. So looking in your future spouse's eyes, Kenneth, I'm going to ask you first. Kenneth, will you keep your vows to Jesus? If so, say I will. Judy, will you keep your vows to Jesus? If so, say I will. Then please stand. Come to the middle. Face each other. And holding right hands, prepare for a supernatural transformation that is second only to your conversion. Kenneth, say to Judy your vows. Judy, today I commit myself to you. I will make our marriage the most important thing in my life. With God as my source of strength, I will protect you. I will provide for you. And most of all, Judy, I will love you forever. Judy, respond to Kenneth with these your vows. Kenneth, I pledge my love to you. My love for you is more than a feeling. It is a decision of which Jesus is the foundation. And for that reason, my love for you will never fade away. I want to be your wife and your lifelong friend. I will share with you in the good times and encourage you when you're down. Where you spiritually lead me, I will follow. In the American culture, a ring on the third finger symbolizes I am married. Kenneth, in the spirit of that public declaration, take this ring, place it upon the finger of your bride, and say to her, I, Kenneth, with this ring, take you, Judy, to be my wife. And by this act, declare in the presence of God, and these our friends and family, that I will be to you a faithful husband. Judy, take this ring that will serve as evidence that you will keep your marriage vows and place it on Kenneth's finger and say to him, I, Judy, with this ring, take you, Kenneth, to be my husband. And by this act, declare in the presence of God and these our friends and family that I will be to you a faithful wife. Now at this moment, Kenneth and Judy are about to light their unity candle. It is the symbol of two lives becoming one. They have asked me to offer you an opportunity to be united with Jesus, just as they have been united with one another. I'm not surprised, it's faith that you lack. I've opened my heart so many times, I'm still keeping track. Invite myself in, but you keep me out. I hope you'll look up, but you keep looking down. I've tried so very hard not to lose you. You've come up with a million excuses. I know you thought of every possibility. And I know today that it'll all turn out. You've made me work so we can work to work it out. And I promise you, kid, that I give so much more than I get. You just haven't met me yet. This is what Jesus says to you. I'll never give up. I'll patiently wait. I know it's half timing, the other half's faith. It could be right now. The timing seems right. I've come out of nowhere and into your life. You know that my grace is so amazing. And kid, my love is gonna change you. And now I can see every possibility. And I know today that it'll all turn out. You've made me work so we can work to work it out. And I promise you, kid, that I give so much more than I get. You just haven't met me yet. Just cast your care on me in prayer. Well, you don't need to fight it. You'll get it right and we'll be united. Kenneth and Judy have been united in relationship. Jesus wants to have that kind of relationship with you. He's what did this for them. They want that for you as well. You know that my grace is so amazing. My being in your life is gonna change you. And now I can see every single possibility. Could this be the day that it all turns out? I've worked to work it out. I promise you, kid, I'll give more than I get. Than I get, than I get, than I get. Oh, I know it'll all turn out. And you know I've worked so we can meet, you work it out. Yeah, I promise you, kid, to give so much more than I get. Yeah, you just haven't met me yet. You just haven't met me yet. Oh, I promise you, kid, to give so much more than I get. I said love, 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 love. You just haven't met me yet. I rose on the third day. I'm here for you today. You just haven't met me yet. Let us pray. Father God, today I ask, show yourself as Savior to anybody who in this room has to say, yeah, me too. I need God. Kenneth and Judy have asked me to lead you in a very simple prayer to meet Jesus. So if you've seen what Jesus has done in them, and you want Jesus to do that in you, would you by faith just pray this prayer after me? And when you hear me say my name, you just insert your name there. And just have enough faith to trust me to lead you to meet Jesus right now. Pray this prayer. Hi, Jesus. I'm Pat. I'd like to say it's good to meet you. Actually, it's kind of weird. I see what you mean to Kenneth and Judy. Clearly, you are alive in them. Be alive in me too. Amen. So, You never prayed the word weird to Jesus, did you? But I get it. God wants you to get it. If you prayed that prayer, and if you're hoping that Jesus can transform you like you've seen him transform Kenneth and Judy, would you please tell them at the reception, I ask Jesus to be alive in me like I see him alive in you. Nothing would bless them more. Their deepest prayer in this ceremony was that people they love who don't know Jesus would know Jesus the way that they do. Now let me pray over them as a couple. Lord, I see them as my children. Lord, I've had the privilege to watch them grow so powerfully in the last few months. And God, you've brought them to this unique time as husband and wife. And this I pray. God, give them the desire of their heart. They want nothing more than you to be glorified through them, both individually and as a couple. Just as they lit those two individual candles, the unity candle burns brighter. May their love for you burn brighter because they are married. In the name of Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. Kenneth and Judy, since you have consented together in holy wedlock and you have pledged your undying devotion to each other, I therefore, as a minister of Jesus Christ and your pastor, declare that you are no longer two. You are one in Christ, husband and wife, in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You can kiss your bride. Ladies and gentlemen, what God has joined together, let nobody tear apart. It's my privilege to introduce to you Mr. and Mrs. Kenneth and Judy Pryor. There's going to be a receiving line right outside. You're going to be dismissed row by row and then instructed to go to the reception, get your beverages. God bless you. Thank you for sharing.